All right. Well, welcome, everyone. I'm Jay Lyman. I'm a librarian with the Seattle Public Library, and I want to welcome you to quickly build your first business website. I'm going to ask, first of all, our interpreters to come onto the screen. We'll start with Spanish, and they'll come on, and they're going to explain in their language how to go into the interpretation. So Iris, do you want, I'll turn off the interpretation so that you can do that. And then we will.
I can do it in English. Can you hear me?
We can.
In the English channel? Okay, yeah, you don't need to turn it off. I can just do it from the English.
Great. I think we still can't hear you.
Yeah, I didn't.
We did hear you, and then now we don't. Here, I'll turn it off, and then we'll restart it.
Okay, cool.
Okay, go ahead, Iris.
Okay. Muy buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Iris Viveros. Un gusto estar aquí con ustedes esta tarde. Para seleccionar la interpretación en español, ustedes pueden encontrar el símbolo redondo del planeta en la parte inferior de la página. Ahí deben de seleccionar el idioma español para que puedan escuchar la información en español y también para seleccionar que las palabras del lenguaje original en inglés no se escuche, igualmente seleccionen Mute Original Audio Feature. Y eso va a apagar el audio original para que no se confundan escuchando los dos idiomas al mismo tiempo. Muchas gracias.
Gracias, Iris. Levine, do you want to please share how to get into the, welcome those in Vietnamese and let them know how to get into the channel there?
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
Yeah. Xin chào quý vị. Quý vị có thể cách dùng nút để phiên dịch. Thứ nhất, quý vị phải tìm ở cuối trang để nhấn nút Translate phiên dịch có hình quả cầu tròn. Thứ hai là quý vị phải bấm vào chữ Select Language chọn ngôn ngữ của mình để tìm chẳng hạn như tiếng Việt để có nghe thông tin bằng tiếng Việt. Cuối cùng, quý vị phải chọn các chữ Mute Original Audio Feature có nghĩa là tắt âm thanh gốc để tránh nghe ngôn ngữ khác cùng lúc vì điều này rất là khó chịu. Xin cảm ơn quý vị.
Thank you, Lily.
You're welcome.
I will turn on the interpretation again and we'll get started with the next part of the program. Okay. So I find it very, very fun to go into those language channels at the very bottom and just hear the interpretation in those beautiful languages. So you can drop in there if you like and listen. Or you know, stay in the English channel. It's really up to you. The other thing we have happening tonight is live captioning. So if you go down to the bottom of the screen, there is a way you can turn on. So you click on the closed caption, show subtitle, and then you'll see the live captioning happening there. So wanted to share those. And again, we are recording tonight, and so we will be making this available after the fact, and think that is it. I think I'm going to turn things over to Michael. Michael, thank you for being here, and take it away.
All right. Well, thank you to everyone that is contributing to this evening. My name is Michael Coffey, and I am the person who is Ardea Coaching. And this is Quickly Build Your First Business Website. I've been helping small businesses for a long time. I was running my first real, in quotes, business that I had started when people were worried about the Y2K bug. So, you know, I've been doing it since the 90s at least. And more recently, I worked with the US Small Business Administration They have a program called the Women's Business Center program. And so I was a counselor to help women and people of color and basically people who are not old, rich white men get into business and be successful. And so I am bringing some of the hot topics that, you know, people would come in and ask about. And we're starting off a series. This is the first one because most people will want a website. And that's a great place to kind of start with. And then there's a lot of, we've got, I believe, 6 additional classes that each kind of add more layers. You can take them individually if you wish. So they're standalone, but they do sort of add additional information to what we'll be learning tonight. So without further ado, I will figure out how to make the slide go forward. Okay. This is my old time picture to remind you that if you are uncomfortable with technology, don't be. Technology is just a new way of doing an old thing. So just like telephones today seem kind of normal when they first were introduced, people were scared of them, but it's just another way to have a conversation, which people have been doing since the beginning of language. So just remember this guy if you find yourself concerned about any of the technology that we're talking about. And then ask a question, put it in the chat. Jay will interrupt me. We also have times that I will break for questions specifically. All right, so the basic elements of a business website are these 5 things here. And this will be sort of the table of contents for our presentation today. The domain, hosting, code, design, and content. So if you already know some of those terms and what they mean, great, you're ahead of the game a little bit, but we're gonna go into each of those things. So I've kind of divided it into 3 sections. The first part will be the 2 registrars and hosts, as well as some of the jargon and technology. The middle part will be about code and design, and then parts 1 and 2 are mostly going to be the same for most businesses and most websites. It's part 3 where it really becomes your website. A little bit in part 2, but the content section is really where it becomes your website for your business. So the beginning will be mostly general, and we'll get more specific into what what your site needs to do as we go on. All right. So first, the basic thing that we should know is how websites work. And if you can understand a house located somewhere, you can understand a website. Because just like a home page is your main page on the internet, so your home is, the place where you live. Specifically, there are 3 parts, these first 3 parts from the table of contents. So the host is like the plot of land that the house is built on. Okay, it's a location. And the second part is the domain. The domain is like the address. Sometimes people will call domain the domain name, like my business is ardeacoaching.com. That's the domain name of my website. And that just helps people find the place where the host is. And then finally is the website. And the website is like the house itself. It's the thing that is built on the land. It is the files, the digital files and images and text and computer code and so forth that make up the website. So I have broken that down here. The code of the website is kind of like the wood and the bricks. It's the stuff that builds the structure. Design is there's two pieces of it that we'll go into more detail later, but design can be like the architect's plan. Where are the rooms? but it can also be like an interior decorator. What color are the drapes? Okay. So design kind of has two parts, but and then finally is the content. And the content is a online web design word for what do you want your website to say or to show? it's the piece that makes the website really yours. Okay, so that's kind of the basic gist of a website and how it works. So before I go into a little bit more technical stuff, does anyone have any questions at this point?
And feel free to say those out loud, unmute yourself, put them in the chat.
Yes.
Either one at this time.
I want to be responsive to whatever your needs are. So, and there are no dumb questions, as they say.
That's right.
All right. Well, then I will move on. So the next piece is zooming in a little bit further on the domain name. So this is the address of your website, and it actually is made up of multiple parts. And it's useful kind of like delivering the mail, the mail carrier, well, the mail system first looks at the zip code, even though we put that at the end, and then move your way up. The domain name kind of works the same way. So at the end, you've got most common is .com, .org, .net, .edu, .gov. I think those were the five original ones. Nowadays, there's so many additional ones. There's .party, .info, .ninja. there's ones for particular industries, .tv. So there's that has exploded. But still, .com, .org, .net, .gov, and .edu are the ones that people think of first. So it's useful, you know, like if you can find a good one with one of those top-level domains, that's cool. You know, like maybe that's better than nothing. Or, you know, like if you have that option, pick it. but if you don't, there's many, many, many other Like if I couldn't get .com today, I might go with ardeacoaching.biz. You know, because that would be just as good, because I, you know, help people with business. So .biz works for me. And you can actually look up on Wikipedia and other sources, but I know Wikipedia has a big list of those top level domains. So that's the first part. And that divides the internet up into sort of the first big chunks. Then comes technically what is the domain. And that's the part that you think of as your business name or your, you know, the .com is kind of on the end, but the domain is, for me, Ardea Coaching. Or for the library, it's SPL. So those two things together is what people think of as the domain name or the website address. And that's where most people stop thinking about it. But there's two more pieces that are important. One is a subdomain. And in my example here on the screen, it says www. The subdomain is like a room in the house. So for instance, if you go to www.facebook.com, for example, it will take you to the main Facebook site. However, they have a version of the site that is optimized for a cell phone. And so if you try to go there with the browser on your cell phone, it will redirect you to m.facebook.com. And that m dot is like a little folder or a little room in the big Facebook domain that's like, oh, here's where we keep all of the mobile visitor stuff. Sometimes if people want to have a website where they sell things, they might have store.yourwebsitehere.com. And all of the store stuff is in that place, and other stuff about their business is on the main, on the www part. So that's a subdomain. You can think of it just like subfolders on your computer. And then last in the red, or first, I suppose, in the red, is the protocol. The http://, stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. And basically what that does is it tells the internet, hold on everyone, there's a website coming through. So be prepared for all of the information that will be associated with making and displaying a website. There are other protocols. You may have heard of FTP, which is File Transfer Protocol. And so that tells the internet, oh, there is a single file coming through and I'm going to send you pieces of it. And then I want you to verify what you got. And I will tell you if that worked. And then I'll send you the next piece, so that you can be sure that you get the file that you want. Okay. But http://, is just sort of, this is a website. A related protocol that is important to know is HTTPS, secure. You'd really like to have that. That's a good thing to have. Look for that if you're about to put in your credit card information or a password or something. Just make sure it has an S up there. let's see. And how do you get one? You talk to a registrar. A registrar, there's a big database in the sky. I My minor is in medieval history. And so I think of, whenever I talk about this, I think of, you know, the Catholics and the Protestants arguing about, like, can you pray directly to God or do you have to have a priest to do it for you? Well, the internet is Catholic. If you want a domain name, you have to talk to a registrar, a priest in this case, who then passes on your request to the big database in the sky. And then you get to know if your prayers are answered and you get the domain name you want. And we'll talk about how to do that. But first I want to mention hosting. Oftentimes registrars and hosts do both, like the same company will do both, but they don't have to be. These are two separate functions. So if you want to have them at two different places, you can do that. A host, however, is like we talked about, the land. So this is somebody else's computer that you put all the files related to your website, your pictures, your text, whatever you want on your website, you send it to this other person's computer that is connected 24/7 to the internet. And you pay them to be the holder of your website. And they worry about things like, what if someone's trying to hack you? Not all the time. Like sometimes that's your issue, but they do some filtering of you know, things that might not be helpful to you. They make sure that the website stays online. Right? So that if you're busy with a customer in the store or whatever, and your website goes down, they will be trying to make it come back up again without you even knowing that the website has gone down. You can host yourself, but then you have to worry about all of those things in addition. So I don't know anyone that self-hosts, at least of small businesses. So it's good to have a host. So do I have any recommendations? Yes, I do. Here's two, dreamhost.com and bluehost.com. They've got great reputations. They are great to use. I personally use Dreamhost, and I would say most of my clients have gone with Bluehost. So I've dealt with them before. The difference between them, because someone's likely to ask, is that Dreamhost is probably the better choice if you're kind of a do-it-yourselfer. If you're willing to, you know, look up how do I do this thing, and you are willing to try and log in and mess around a little bit. Dreamhost is great for that. Bluehost, on the other hand, is a little better if you want someone to hold your hand through whatever you're trying to do. So they have a little bit more customer service worked into their prices and their plans and that sort of thing. Whereas Dreamhost has an extensive database of, here's how you do this. Oh, you want to connect this thing with that other thing? Here are the steps to do it. And so you can look that up and learn how to do it on your own and do it that way. So Dreamhost and Bluehost. And they also have the stuff that you'll need for the other things we'll be talking about today. And just as a you know, a peek, it doesn't quite look like this anymore. Their design is always changing, but it's basically a three-step process. Step one, this is Dreamhost. Step one, you would click on Manage Domains. Step two, you would say, I would like to register a new domain. And then you say, I want it to be ardeacoaching.com or whatever. Don't say that because I already have it. And then once you get whatever domain you decide you want, you can click add hosting. And now you have a domain and you have hosting. Three steps, done. Okay. Whew, there was some technology there. any questions?
We do have a question.
Excellent.
So question is, I hear that .com is better when clients need to research your business. Is that right?
I don't know that that's necessarily true. Other than the fact that, I mean, there's sort of some, let's say systemic biases in the internet, where, for example, one of the signals of quality that Google uses in coming up with where do you, you know, like what gets sorted where, is how long has this website been around? And, you know, a lot of .coms have been around for a while. So, you know, like you might get a little bit of a boost there in being found in a search engine if you had a .com. But really, if someone types in your web address, you know, they'll go there. But if your business is mybusiness.biz and people don't know that, they might type in mybusiness.com and go somewhere else. So it's more about how well do you communicate what that ending is, than it is that it's, you know, necessarily better. It's just that .com's been around forever. So, and yes, I just saw Tisha's question. Both Dreamhost and Bluehost can host and register both. Or if you're feeling super creative, you could use one as your registrar and one as your host and just point them at each other. But it's kind of easier if they're both in the same place. Any other questions? I will say that hosting is going to be your more expensive thing. So hosting, depending on your plan, might be like $10 a month, whereas a domain name is more like $10 a year. So hosting is, you know, 10-ish times more expensive, but you can get a year of hosting and a domain name for less than $150 in a lot of places. You know, like look for deals and search around and, you know, but yeah, like that's very generally the ballpark you're looking at. Okay. Nothing else, then I will move on. So
how much does it cost, Michael?
That's sort of what I was just saying. The domain name is usually around it. It also depends on the top level domain, the .com or whatever. Some of the more specialty ones cost more. You know, which could be fine or not fine depending on your situation. It's really sort of up to what do you want to do. more than any technical sort of thing.
Got it. Thank you.
Yep. Okay, so here is scary code. So here's how you program a website. No, you don't need to program a website.
It is October, so yeah, we got scary slides going.
Yeah. No, you don't need to learn to program. Although, really, a basic website doesn't take a whole lot of programming skill. Like you can look at this code, and that's one of the reasons I actually put code on here, is that even if you don't, this is programmed in a language called PHP, and I don't even know what PHP stands for. Doesn't matter. But you can look at it and you can say, okay, main content, right? One thing to know about a lot of website coding is if you have those two brackets, I just made a internet coding pun for those that know it, because there is so when you have these brackets with something in between, it's known as a tag. And that's usually like, oh, here's a chunk, here's a thing that we're trying to do. And there is one called head. There's a head tag. but in this case, we have a main content tag. Okay, what do you suppose is in the main content tag? Probably we're going to see some main content for the page. And then we've got, let's see, ID, outer main, class container. Okay, so we've got like the main page or something like that, and we've got a container for some stuff. Okay, so far so good. It's talking about widgets and sidebar widgets that come before the content. Okay, so, you know, like widgets at the top or on the left. We've got a widget area. If the dynamic sidebar is before the content, okay? So it's like, it's going through layout kinds of things here, right? Section, ID, main content, 12 columns, okay? So it's dividing up the page. You know, you can have multiple things in different places. But it's also got an option for one column, it looks like, or nine columns. So there's different possible layouts here. Typically, one column is preserved for if you're connecting with a mobile device. You know, so you can. It's not too scary to look at the code, and if you can see the code, go for it. Take a look and see what you can pick out of it, even without knowing how to code. But all that said, it's easier to install a CMS. CMS stands for Content Management System. And a content management system is a program that does the programming for you. I mean, that sounds kind of weird saying it that way, but that's what it does. So I have a recommendation. You should use WordPress. Now, there's different ways to use WordPress. So I have on the slide here specifically installed on your domain, on your site. So, because you can use the WordPress organization as your host, but you'd like to keep it for yourself. So you can download their software and install it on your host. It's free. And it is, you can turn WordPress into anything. And we'll be talking about how to do that later. But it is estimated that possibly a quarter of all websites in the world are run by WordPress. So that means that it will be very easy if you need help on any aspect of your website for you to find someone that says, oh yeah, I know how to do that in WordPress. So it gives you a basis of commonality with lots and lots of people who do website stuff. Yes, it may turn off a few people, but yeah, there's a huge, huge pool of people that can help you with WordPress things. Okay. And I see a comment. I'm going to come back to that when I get to my question break, which will be here in a second. But it's even easier than downloading it and installing it yourself. In both Bluehost and Dreamhost, they have, I think it's called something slightly different in Bluehost, not one-click install, but it's like a, it's something like that. I just can't remember what it's, what the term is. But basically you say, hey, I want to do one of these one-click installs. And then you say, I want it to be WordPress. And it brings up a window sort of like this. You have install to select a domain. So you drop that down and you'd pick the domain that you just registered. You would leave this box blank. This is if you wanted it in like a subfolder or something like that, but you want WordPress for like your whole website. So you just leave that box empty. Do you want to automatically create the database? Yeah, heck yeah. Who wants to sit around on a lovely day creating a database, right? So yes, automatically create it for me. And check the deluxe install. Of course, we want the deluxe version, of course. And then here's your one click for the one click install. Install it for me. Boom. You now have a CMS installed on your host. Oh, and that is the time for question. So the confusion that was just mentioned, did what I just say clear that up? No. Okay, great. So let me just really quickly go back in. So the question is, are website builders different than hosts and registrars, or can they be the same? Technically, they are three different things. However, because businesses that do those three things know that usually all three things get done at the same time. And if you're doing one of them, you're going to do the other two. They kind of grow together. So so I'm going to use Dreamhost because that's on the screen here, and that's the one I know better. Dreamhost is a host. But they also provide registrar services. So if you buy hosting with them, they're like, okay, well, we'll throw in a free domain name or whatever. Okay, so then you register with them. It's like, okay, now you have a nice cleared plot of land. What are you gonna build? Well, you could build something from scratch and that would be fine. But you know, like maybe you want a little prefab something. and that's when you do a website builder or content management software. So website builders like Wix and Weebly started off just as website builders, and they added hosting. One of the reasons I don't recommend those in general is that they have a lot of designs that are proprietary. And so if you happen to use one of their designs and you really fall in love with it, and then you decide to leave them, you have to redesign your whole website. With DreamHost, or not with DreamHost, with WordPress, and we'll talk about design later, but let's say you get a design that you really like, even if it's a prefab sort of thing, you can export your whole site into a giant file and then go to a different host and a different registrar and say, hey, I want to use WordPress over here. And they're like, okay, cool, whatever, do your thing. And then you upload it, and now your same design has been moved to a new location. So that's kind of where some of those website builders diverge from WordPress. But the host is just like, where is that stuff? Where is that stuff located? What computer did I save those files to? Does that help? Now the confusion is clear. Excellent. I win. Okay, any other questions? Can you edit code directly while using WordPress? Yes, you can. So that's another layer that I like about WordPress, is that because it is, I don't know if it's technically open source. I think it is. If not, it is very like open source, which means that it is set up to make things easy for you. Easy-ish. I mean, like anything that can do as much as WordPress can do has its complications. But in general, it's pretty straightforward. You want a page that says this stuff, you click create page and you name it and you put the stuff you want in the little box, like a, you know, like a word processor. Done. But those who want to dig in to the technical stuff, the code and so forth, you can do that too. There's a little area where you can go in and you can see all of the little files that have code that do different pieces of it, like handling widgets on the main page or whatever. You can get in there and fiddle with that as well. So if you know what a CSS is, you can go in and, you know, do your own custom CSS, and that's great. And for those that don't know what that is, it stands for cascading style sheet. And that's the way that you get a consistent look. You say, like, I want all of the big headers to be in fuchsia, and I want the background to be lime green, and I want, you know, like, you can tell I'm not a I'm not a designer, but that's what a CSS is. It's just kind of like, hey, this is what I want the standard to look like. Other questions? Okay, well, then away we go. I just messed up the chat. Well, I didn't mess it up, but okay. All right, so design. You can, as a business owner, hire a web designer. And you can specify the most minute details to your designer and say, make my website look like this. And I know some web designers who have had clients who have, you know, been like, I want this to be 1 pixel on the screen wider than you made it. You know, you can have that level of detail. that also is extremely expensive in many cases. I mean, if you're a big business, not extremely expensive, but you know, like if you're on a shoestring budget, it can, you know, it can be in the thousands of dollars. Because you are paying for someone to choose images and choose colors and change the code on your website to make it look exactly the way that you're specifying. And build that from the ground up in many cases, right? Because you're going for some big custom thing. But you don't have, there's a quicker and cheaper way of doing this. And I'll mention that in the next screen. That's for the pretty part. That's the interior decorator part. And that's usually called a web designer. Now that overlaps with another profession, I guess, another focus, and that is a web developer. A web developer focuses on the code. It's someone who, it's like the architect part of design. And both have to do code, but a web developer does code that makes your website do something it didn't before, or arranges how the parts of your website work together, or those kinds of things. Designers tend to, you know, work with color and placement on the page and font and those sorts of things. But, you know, they overlap. A lot of developers can do some design and a lot of designers can do some development. But it's useful to kind of know those terms and how what they specialize in. Okay. Now, rather than hiring, so the CMS, WordPress, is essentially your developer, right? It's taking over for having someone build your website from scratch. A theme is your cheaper version of hiring a designer. So themes, so if I were a designer, I could try to get you to hire me for $2,000 to do your website, make it all pretty. But I could also say, well, I'm a creative person. I'm going to just design a website. I'm just going to I'm going to pick colors and fonts and how do the menus, you know, do they drop down from the top or are they on the side or, you know, I'm going to just do that design. And then I can sell the right to use that design to whoever wants to buy it. That way, I can get money and I don't have to find a client. And maybe lots and lots and lots of people will like that design because I'm pretty good at designing. And I might make more money selling it at a lower price. So themes are kind of like a template for a design. You can just install them on WordPress and it will change how WordPress looks. It'll change where the menus are, it'll change the colors, it'll change, you know, layout and those sorts of things. But like I said earlier, you can get in there and, you know, dink around and change things and adjust this and remove that and make it more like yours. So when you're shopping for a theme, you can look for something that is pretty close to what you want. And then choose that and adjust it. And that is going to be way cheaper than having someone build something entirely from scratch. Now, if you're really fussy about all of the details, absolutely hire someone, build it from scratch. But if you're on a budget, go with themes. Close enough is how themes work. So where do you get them? A couple of places. There's dozens, maybe hundreds of places where you can shop for WordPress themes. But I want to make it easy for you. So here are two that are really good choices. Themeforest.net and inkthemes.com. So you can go to either of these places and say, I am looking for a WordPress theme, and, you know, like choose the filter, you know, whatever, and or the menu or however they do it. And then just look through. And if you see something that's like, yeah, that's kind of how I want my website to look, because some of them look like super sleek, like black and white and, big splashy images and whatever. And other ones are like, flowery and lots of little, decorations and details and, find something that's kind of the right style. And then, like I said, you can adjust it. Okay. Now, the one thing you want to look for is, the one thing I see that I've been anticipated. So the one thing you want to look for is that your theme is responsive. You want to look for that word. Most themes these days are responsive. But if you have ever gone to, say, a government website on your phone and it's, the text is tiny and, you can hardly see anything, and the buttons are like this big, and that was not responsive. That was a website that was designed for a desktop computer, and you're viewing it on a tiny screen and it can't handle that. Responsive is, it'll say, okay, who's visiting? Are you a small screen or a big screen? And it will change the design to be appropriate for the size of the screen that's viewing it. And since so many people view websites on their phones or their tablets, it's a good idea to have that. It won't break anything. If you absolutely fall in love with a theme that is not responsive, that's okay. Just know that you're going to be irritating the people that, come on their phones, right? Like visit from their phones. So that's just what you're looking for. Really, most of the ones that are done these days are responsive. It was mostly responsive themes even a couple of years ago, and it's only gotten more so since the pandemic, with everyone being everything online. So that's just what to look for, and it just means that it makes it look nice on a big screen or a small screen. Yes, it should say somewhere in the description, I call this theme Manhattan, a responsive theme for, for this, whatever. So it will, excuse me. Yeah, it'll either have specifically listed as a feature that it's responsive, or it'll say responsive in the description. And if you're not sure, is absolutely a cool thing to do, to contact, you know, whoever is selling it and saying, you know, is this theme responsive? Or, you know, look at reviews to see if someone has said, you know, oh, I installed this and it's not responsive. But that's the jargon word that gets you what you're looking for. Okay, before I move on to content, I'll quickly check in. You can also simulate. Yes. Yes. So there are tools that you can get online, your browser, whatever, to view a website as if you are seeing it on mobile. Google has a thing called Webmaster Tools. No, they renamed it. And I never learned the new name. It's Webmaster Tools. I think the web address is still Webmaster Tools. Anyway, you know, Google has ways. All of this is information for a later class, but there are tools that you can get that will actually analyze how long it takes to load on a phone versus how long it takes to load on a desktop or those kinds of things. Other questions? What's our time? Okay. All right. I will move on. Content. Content is your text, your product descriptions, your product shots, your testimonials, your profile on your employee of the month, your about us page, your directions to your store, pictures of your store, pictures of you, all of that. That is your content. Right, you have built an edifice out of code and design and electrons, and now you're moving in, and your content is like your bed and your couch and your whatever else. Okay, your books, yay books. Here's something to do, you know, like if you have a piece of paper or just in your brain or whatever. On the left of the screen here, I say plan your site. And I think these four pages are kind of the minimum. Some places will talk about your three-page brochure website or something like that. But you know, three pages, four pages, that's, you know, you're talking a brochure, an internet brochure. But you should have these roughly four pages. You should have something about what you're offering. You know, like what product do you sell or what service do you provide to your clients? Okay, describe that or show it or whatever. Right? You need at least one page of that. But, you know, I had a client that I worked with that had thousands of products because they sold, like, you know, screws and brackets and, you know, like all kinds of little pieces. And so they had thousands and thousands and thousands of pages that just fit under the category of product. You might only have one. Right. If you're a business coach, you might just say, hey, I help people with their business stuff or online marketing or whatever you say. I give people massages and they feel really good. Whatever. So you should have a page, at least one, about what you offer. Second, you should have an about us page or about me. You can call it whatever you want, but there should be, because a lot of people will check out a business, and there was a question about this earlier, will check out a business through their website before they actually decide to buy. It's a research thing. So you should talk about, you know, do you have a story about how the business was founded, or why you started this business? You know, like, what need did you see that inspired you to start this business? Or why are you the person to provide this service? Like, what makes you special? Or maybe you've gathered a super duper team, and it's the team that's cool that you want to talk about, you know, or a location, right? It's you know, you have a Airbnb or something like that, and it's like super unique because you get to look out over the vistas, or, you know, that's kind of in the product, but it's also, it can also be a little bit about us, right? Let people get to know you. Third one, some sort of way for them to contact you and or lead capture. So lead capture is like sign up for our newsletter. It allows someone to interact with you in a way that you can say, okay, this person was at least interested enough to fill in that form, or to put in their email address, you know, to get the downloaded, you know, like you have a PDF document that's tips for camping or whatever. You know, like, have some way that you can interact with a visitor, because that's usually the first step toward making, toward either you selling to them or them deciding to make a purchase. And then finally, you should have a privacy policy. You should say, you know, explicitly, we're not going to sell your information. There are an increasing number of laws related to internet privacy, and some places do it better than others. But the privacy policy is the fourth one. When people talk about a three-page website, they usually are not talking about the privacy policy. It's also good to have a footer that has a copyright. So you just say, this is my website, you can't steal it, because that happens as well. I used to do a lot of work in the tea industry. I do that less now. Yes, that's the big irony of my life. My last name is Coffee, but I taught people about tea. I know people who, I know someone who sent out reviews, one person who sent out a review copy of their book, and someone else took all of the text from their book, typed it into their own website, and was like, look at this cool thing that I made. I know someone else who traveled to Taiwan and learned about picking tea and had pictures of her, you know, in the tea fields picking. And I saw her being, her picture of her in the tea fields of Taiwan being used to sell a weight loss tea from China. So, you know, like, if you have a copyright footer at the bottom of each page that says all of this stuff is my stuff, then you have a little bit of legal protection. So, minimum. On the right-hand side, you have some other stuff that you may want to consider. Do you want people to come to a physical location to shop? Having a map might be useful. Like, oh, you have to go down the alley and around behind in order to find the parking lot or whatever. Maybe you want to have a blog. A blog is a great way of regularly staying in contact with people that are interested in you or in your business or what you're doing. Social media, if you want to do that, we have a social media class and I think a blogging class. I think both of those are coming up. I don't remember what we have in our lineup in this particular series, but I'm sure Jay will let us know at the end. Or maybe you have some other feature that you think is important. So think about that when you're planning, right? What do I have to have there? All this you can just make in WordPress. And then for each of those pages, outline it. So pick a page that you have decided. Write one sentence encapsulating what you're trying to get across. What is the purpose of this page? When someone visits, what do you want them to learn or do? Grab that as a specific sentence. This page is for, or when someone visits here, I want them to learn that, something like that. And then in service of that, what images do you need? Maybe you don't need any. Maybe you want an image that shows something in particular. Maybe you just want to convey a feeling. I had a client who did a lot of financial planning, and most of his images were like of mountains and babbling brooks because he wanted to convey a feeling of relaxation, that's the word, a feeling of relaxation. I'm like, oh, okay, I don't have to worry, right? It's not like mountains and streams show that he's a good financial planner, but it does convey something. Do you need links? Do you need links to other pages or to websites that are off your site? Right? What's going to support that first sentence? And then if you're really interested in the design, you can wireframe the page. And that's what this this image here shows. It's just like, okay, I've written a bunch of lines here and that represents the text. And then I have a box with an X in it and that represents where the images will go. And you can see sort of down here at the bottom of the page, it looks like there's a play button in the middle of some of those. So like if you're gonna have videos, demonstration or something, and you can just sort of lay it out. And that will help you if you are trying to design the page, or if you give it to someone else and say, I don't know how to do this, but this is what I'm thinking of. And that will really go a long way to help. Again, I've talked to a number of designers and developers, and I was like, how would you feel if a client came to you with wireframes of their pages? And they're like, oh my God, that would be amazing. So, because usually their clients come to them with like, yeah, I want it to be pretty and, kind of like, oh, no, not like that. Right? Like, but if you can specify what you're thinking in a very simple way, that's really going to help them. Okay. Any questions? I just have a few more slides after this and we can have some Q&A, but, one check. So I'm going to just zoom back here a little bit. The content is what makes it yours. You've got some basic things that you want, but what's your vision? Get it out of your head and into the world in a specific way. And think of each web page as its own thing. There is a guy by the name of Seth Godin. I'm looking at my bookshelf. Guy by the name of Seth Godin, and He wrote a book a million years ago. It's very dated now, but the basic idea is still solid. It's called the Big Red Fez. And he's like, think of one of those little, you know, old timey organ grinder monkeys with a little red fez on. And, you know, like your website visitors are like those little monkeys. And so if you want them to eventually make it to your cash register, you have to set out bananas, you know, like, where's the banana on this page, right? What should they click, and where will that take them, right? Lay out those pathways to moving towards what you want. Okay, if there's no additional questions, I'll just zoom through a few last things. If you want more functions, WordPress does a thing called plugins. Plugins are just like you might think that they are. They're like apps on your phone. They just add a function. They do a thing. Some of them are kind of silly. There is one that is standard, and I don't know why, but it's when you log into your administrative area, it displays a line from a song from Hello Dolly at the top. Okay. I think someone who started WordPress liked Hello Dolly or something. I don't know. But there are also plugins that are just huge, massive things. Like if you have ever taken an online class from, Udemy or any of those, what is it called? Udacity? Is that the, anyway, like any of those kinds of places, there are plugins that will make your WordPress site into an online university. So any sort of function you can add with a plugin, that is another way of sort of replacing a web developer. Find someone who's done a similar thing and install it. Many of them are free, some of them are paid. Creating pages, we kind of talked about this. And last but not least, because we are at the end here, sort of, a little bit of homework. If you're going to be taking next week's class, something to think about is a target market. And if you are at the stage of business where you haven't thought of a target market, now's a great time to do it. And that's a group of similar people that you would like to do business with. Either they have a need that you can meet, or you just like working with this kind of person, or whatever. And spend a little bit of time. The library can help. Figuring out, what do I know about this sort of person? Where do they go? What do they do? How do they think? Because that kind of information we will talk about next week. But I will let Jay sort of mention what services the library has that can help with that. But that's your assignment, is you know, over the next week, think about who you want to do business with. You may already know, but you can always do some more research. Where to go from here? Sign up for the next class. Here's just some other ideas about website related things, like where might you go? We have some classes about like Google Analytics. You know, you could brainstorm plugins that you might like, think about blogging as a potential. But just some ideas to kind of inspire you thinking about what's next for your website. And I'll just leave this for you This is basically, if we had lots of extra time, I could talk about different ways people make it to your website, but I will just simplify this by saying there are lots of ways people find your site, and each way has its own methods of marketing. So there are many ways of marketing a website, and they all lead to different kinds of traffic. Always give credit to where you got your images. And thank you. Anyone have any questions?
Well, I'll just add the next one in the series is Elements of Strategic Marketing. And that's October 13th at 6:30. So same time of the day. All these are the same time of the day and all on Thursdays. You can sign up for that one. And but we also have other classes between now and then. We have a lot of things happening. We have personal credit consults where you can meet with Tierra Bonds and she'll give you specific suggestions on how to improve your credit. Because if you're a small business that's going to go out and ask for a loan, you can improve the terms of that loan by cleaning up your credit ahead of time. And I sat in two of those today.
Or tip the balance from no loan to a loan.
Precisely. Improve terms, like yes or no.
Like having terms, yeah.
Those terms. So we have those happening. There's a whole bunch of them that are coming up. So, they're all free. They're all virtual. So I put the link in the chat for you there.
I can also stop sharing my screen.
Yeah, and why don't we go ahead and close out the recordings and, sort of, then maybe there might be questions too at that point. So I just want to thank everyone for being here. If you're here in the room, you can stick around and we'll have the recording off and you can ask specific questions if you were maybe just didn't want to be on camera. But thank you all for being here tonight. And thank you to our captioner. Thank you to our interpreters. thank you to Emily, who's been working in the background. This has been a lot of fun. So, all right. So, Emily, I'll let you go ahead and stop your recording. I'm going to stop mine.